So I'm glad to introduce Elisa Sovrano from Centre d'Analyse et de Mathématiques Sociales. And she will talk about the wavefronts for the reactive convective Perron-Amalic equation. Thank you, Elisa.
Thank you very much, Benedetta. And also thank you to Francesca and Alberto for the kind invitation. And today I'm very glad to share with you a very recent result obtained in collaboration with Andrea Corley and Luisa Malaguti. And so we are going to talk about Perron-Amalic diffusion. And just to motivate and recall the basic properties of that kind of diffusion. I will also speak a little about the regularity of solutions for such kind of equations, which is a key point to understand better that diffusion. And then we skip to the problem formulation. So I will present the problem that I investigated, and in particular we are going to talk about the existence and the regularity of traveling waves, or that that I call also briefly wavefronts, and the properties for that solutions. So just to start, the diffusion of Perron-Amalic was introduced by Perron and Malik in that paper in order to deal with images which have noise and try to reduce the noise, but also try to fixing the edges. So the equation is a forward parabolic equation where we have a nonlinear term G, which is a bounded and non-monotone nonlinearity, which tends to zero at infinity, both at plus and minus infinity. So a very typical example is given by that that function. So we see that in particular the diffusion will be degenerate, but also will be weak and negative when the gradient is large. And so in that way, you can detect the edges in an image. But also it is strong and positive when the gradient is small. After that, in the literature, we can find other parabolic equations where the authors have added a convection term, in that case from the in the field of image processing. This results in image in painting, but also they add, instead of a convection term, a nonlinear term, which is given by a function f, which could be positive, but also have some zeros inside its domain. And so through the nodal behavior of that function, you can allow a different extraction of different grade levels. And so you can make the contrast of an image better. But I would like also to point out that the study of a diffusion equation with a Perron-Amalic diffusion, both involving a convection and a nonlinear term, as far as I know, in the literature is not taken into account. And so we have here a lot of interest in study the initial value problems also here, and also the study of traveling wave solutions. But understand the behavior, for example, of a traveling wave solution when we have both a convection term and a nonlinear term, even if in one dimension is not studied yet. And so this will be the motivation in doing that investigation. And here I would like to just to take into account a very simple convection diffusion equation. Here we have a Burger type convection, and here there is a non-linearity of peronomalic type that we have seen at the beginning of the talk. And if we would like to look for wave fronts that are families of solutions which were of that kind, where for me, C will stand for the wave variable, phi is the profile, and C is the wave speed. Looking for that kind of solutions, if we want to study, for example, decreasing profiles, and we look for profiles satisfying that boundaries conditions, we see that the profile is continuous if and only if the boundary condition L is between 0 and 2. The condition that L is greater than 0, it is related with the convection term. But the threshold L less than 2, it is related with the nonlinear diffusion, that kind of nonlinear diffusion. And in particular, in that references, there are a lot of numerical computations that show that the slope of the profile, so prime phi here, increase as L increase. And also the slope here of the profile is equal to the threshold, in that case, minus one, because we have that kind of nonlinear diffusion, gives rise to a profile which is discontinuous. And for who is familiar, for example, with the mean curvature operator, so when we have u prime over the square of 1 plus u prime. So this is the classical mean curvature operator. In that case, we can have also profiles which are discontinuous, but the point where we have the discontinuity, in that point, the slope, the gradient blows up. So this is an important difference between the two degenerate nonlinear diffusion terms. And so in that way, we can see that it is important to study also for the peronomalic equations the regularity of our solutions. Okay. So this is the problem that we are going to study. So we have a convection term, which is a C1 function, for example, the one depicted here. And for the diffusion term, we assume that is a C1 function, which tends to zero at plus and minus infinity. And it is decreasing TL minus K, then becomes increasing, and then it is again decreasing. It is not important that the points where there is a change of monotonicity are in some sense symmetric. This is not an important thing. It's just for simplicity. As for the reaction term, we assume that it is a monostable reaction term. So we take a continuous function, which takes zero value in zero and one. Inside it is positive, and then we assume a natural assumption in the neighborhood of zero, like the one that has assumed Andrea in the previous talk. If f is derivable, you can just think about f prime of zero positive. Okay, and for that problem, if we want to study a wavefront solution, a wavefront between two stationary solutions, which are in our case the constant function zero and the constant function one, you can prove that type of profiles are monotone. And so for simplicity, I want to deal just with the decreasing one. And in that joint work with Luisa Malaguti and Andrea Corli, we gave a complete description of the solution set of regular wave fronts. In particular, we proved when they exist, when they not exist, and also we point out several properties, also including the slope of the profiles. So just to be more rigorous, the definition of wave fronts that we are going to take into account from now on is a function u that can be expressed through its profile phi, which is a non-constant decreasing function of class C1. G of phi prime is local absolutely continuous, and it solves almost everywhere in R that equation. And you can arrive to that equation just by substituting here in our equation the expression of the wavefront. And dealing with that kind of solutions, we have to be aware that we can have three different kind of wavefronts. The first one is subcritical, when the slope is always greater than minus k. Minus k, I remember, that it is the critical point of the nonlinear diffusion. So it will be critical if at least at some point it assumes a value minus k, and it is subcritical if the slope it exceeds the threshold value minus k. So we have these three different kinds of wave fronts, which are distinguished thanks to the behavior of the derivative of the profile. Just to start, some basic properties for that solutions are if they are decreasing, they satisfy the boundary condition at minus infinity and plus infinity. So they are in between the two stationary solutions, and in some sense the profile connect these two stationary solutions. And the slope at minus plus infinity of the profile is equal to zero. Inside, they have derivative different from zero. So in our case, it is less than zero, but it also holds if you want to deal with increasing profiles. And in every interval where the derivative of the profile does not meet the value minus k, the profile is of class C2. Remember that the definition in general is of class C1. Okay, so another interesting feature of that profiles is that if there is a point where the slope takes a value minus k, then the speed of the wave has to verify that equality. So this means that if we take the graph of that function and we look at the intersection between the level C and the graph, we say that if we have a critical profile, so when it happens that the slope takes value minus k in some point, then that red line has to cross the graph of that function. But this is just necessary. So if that happens also for other points, we cannot be sure that the profile we have found is a critical one. But what it is right is that in the region over, so in the yellow region, we can find only subcritical profile if they exist. Okay, this is just a little remark. So, what about the function G? G is a particular function and it has some properties which are important in order to understand when there is or not a wavefront. In particular, the first one is that there exists a function G that allows to express the nonlinear diffusion in that way. And in particular, in the sequel, I will refer to that constant, which is the minimum of the little function G and the maximum of the function G that I introduce here. And that quantities belongs to that region minus KK. For the nonlinearity capital G, we have also to observe that the inverse of that function is made by three branches. The first one is belongs to that that part of the function g where it is decreasing. Another one where it is decreasing but for positive values of s, and an intermediate one for the part where g is increasing. Dealing with decreasing profiles, the part of the nonlinear diffusions which we will exploit is just that one. And so we take these two inverse branches, which are defined between g of minus k zero and the other, and which takes value in minus k zero, and the other one which takes values in minus k here there is a little mistake, sorry, minus k minus infinity. Okay, so these are the two inverses of the function g which are important for our purpose. And so we are now ready to see the first result about existence of subcritical and critical wavefronts, which says that our equation has a unique up to shifts, okay, wavefront solution, which is or subcritical or critical for if and only if the wave speed C is greater or equal than the threshold value C0. There is also an estimate for that threshold speed, which is a little ugly, but if you take a function H, which is concave, and also a function f which is concave and differentiable at zero. Okay, here small h is the derivative of capital H, just standard notation. Okay, in that case, we have that estimate for the threshold speed C0. What we can observe is, if we remember also the estimates of Andrea, we have here a value gm, which is the minimum of g, which plays essentially the role of the diffusion that he talked about before, and the same here. What is new here is that part. That part comes from the fact that we have a non-linear diffusion of paranormalic type. And so if the value g minus k is very big, we recover the classical estimate. But if not, we have a new upper bound for our speed C0. Okay. So in order to prove that result, we have looked for a reduction to a first order problem. So since phi is decreasing, we can take the inverse function, and then by defining the function w as follows, we can have an equivalent formulation of the boundary value problem, where here I remember there is the equation in the definition of the wavefront that comes from the equation E, which is equivalent to the first order singular problem here, W star. And how to say that? Okay, if we assume that we have a solution of that problem, then the way to see the first implication is just to take the Dirichlet problem, which is given by phi prime equal to g, the inverse of g applied to the solution w. We can do that because we are in that region, so we can take the inverse function. This is the key point. For that reason, we will find solutions which can be subcritical or critical. And then we take in zero, for example, the value 1/2. Okay. And the other implication comes from the definition of the problem. So another remark is that we can prove that that problem, which is singular, is it has also at most one solution. So if we find a solution of that problem, this solution is unique, and so we find a unique up to translation wavefront solution to that problem. And we have that tool, we can see it graphically. So here we have the solution of the first order problem. And what we have to have in mind is also the slope of the profile. So when the solution reaches a value g minus k, which is negative, then there is a point where our profile takes value minus k. This is due to the definition which is written here, just for the definition. And analogously, if we have a subcritical profile, so we are dealing with a solution of the first order problem W, which does not meet that threshold. And so the corresponding slope of the profile do the same. So it does not cross the value minus k. The fact that we have that equivalence, it is very useful because now we are going to study the when the first order problem here is solvable and for which c value of the parameter c it is solvable and for which values we are in that case or in that case. So the first point is study the existence. In order to study the existence, we have thought about a topological approach. And so we have take a set S of the functions which are in between minus k and zero. That set is closed, convex, and bounded. And then we have proved that if the parameter C is large enough, then that first order problem has a unique solution. It is slightly different from that one, because here we have the inverse of the function g, but here we have the function f, which times the little function g, which is never than the function g capital G times v over now f the function omega. So this problem is more simple to try to study, because we don't have at the denominator the nonlinearity, the inverse of the nonlinearity G. This is the flavor to deal with that problem instead of studying right the other one. And then you can take the operator that associate to V, G, the inverse function applied to the solution of that function, of that problem. And so this, you can prove that this is a compact operator, and also the image of the set S is contained on S, and so we can apply the Schauder fixed point theorem. And so that operator has a fixed point, and due to the decomposition of the function G, we just have that equality, and so we reduce to the other problem. And in that way, the solution to that problem solves also our equivalent first order problem. And so due to the equivalence between the problem we are studying with the first order problem, we can say that when the parameter C, so when the speed is large enough, we have a wavefront solution. I don't want to bother you about the estimates, but in order to have that problem solvable, we have to take into account different factors. One is about the solvability of the first order problems, and the other is the fact that here we want an upper bound for the solution. And so we give an estimate which depends on that quantities. For the non-existence, the study is simple, because we can prove that our first order problem we want to investigate is solvable. When it is solvable, then also that auxiliary first order problem is solvable for the same C. These problems are well studied by Luisa Malaguti and Andrea Corli. So we have estimates for the threshold speed of the wavefronts for the associated reaction diffusion, reaction convection diffusion problem. And for P1, the estimate of the threshold is the one that we see here. And for the lower bound, because now we have to see that, because that result gave us a non-existent result for our equation, because we know now that if that problem is not solvable, then also our problem is not solvable. From that result, we have here the upper bound. We have to also to notice that the same result applies if here, instead of the constant, which is the minimum of G, we take the maximum of G. And this is important because give us part of the upper bound, not of the lower bound, which is that part here that you have. It doesn't work. That you have here. So in that sense, I said that you have a part that becomes from the threshold speed of an auxiliary problem and a part that comes from an a priori bound, which is not stated here. So this, just to recap, we are now in that position. So at the left of that value, we don't have existence, but at the right of that value, we have existence. So by taking the set where our equivalent problem is solvable, we are left just to prove that it has a minimum, and that minimum is the threshold speed. In order to do that, the important result that we have proof is a comparison between the solutions. So if we have two speeds which are ordered in that way, then the solutions satisfies the solution W1 and the solution W2 satisfy that chain of inequalities. This is the key result in order to prove the existence of a minimum of the set C. With that,
sorry, cannot...
yes,
I kindly ask you to go towards the conclusion.
Yes, sorry. Just with that, we can prove that critical wavefronts appear just when the speed is C0. And these are the examples. And what about supercritical wavefronts? Supercritical wavefronts does not exist for that equation. Because they have to alternatively solve two different first order equations. And by assuming by contradiction that you have a profile which is supercritical, you reach a contradiction because that situation can never hold. And this is just to conclude.